Existe un lumina, pero no vamos a tener una parte de la comentario. El primo lumina es venir a hecho introducir The Animal Planet, un tot el film de Monster Sense Animal. Sunt intrate și în limba română. Sunt două cazuri foarte importante care m-au zis sau trebuie să dau...
M-au zis acum?
Da.
Da. Deci sunt două cazuri foarte importante care v-aș ajuta foarte mult să-l urmăriți, pentru că de aici o să fie o colaborare foarte frumoasă astăzi cu toate conștiințele care s-au invat în stat asta. Și dacă ați decis să veniți, nu e întâmplător și chiar vă mulțumesc foarte mult. Și după ce vedem filmele, normal că o să fiți foarte interesați ca să vedeți tehnologia noastră ce poate să rezolve, pentru că ei nu rezolvă cazurile nici în Statele Unite ale Americii, fiind vorba de paraziți. Deci acum vă las în liniște să auziți.
Best friend, Jen Ittenberg.
Jenny is the kind of person
religion is an important part of Jeremy's life.
I'm very proud of my Judaism. I'm very active and love the outdoors. And some parts of Judaism just appreciate trees, appreciate nature, appreciate life.
It was early spring, and Jenny was hard at work.
I'm very passionate about my job, and I work really hard, and it's a very stressful job sometimes. One day I was at my office just typing, and all of a sudden my heart started fluttering. I held my hand right here, I could have felt my heart and then catch back up, almost like it was going to come out of my chest, and it took my breath away. And I thought, well, maybe I was thinking about something stressful, and I just had like low anxiety. I wanted to push it out of my head and think it's nothing, I'll be fine, because I really didn't want it to get in the way of my life.
Over the next couple of months, Jenny tried to manage her anxiety through exercise.
One day I was running and I started developing this discomfort right below my rib cage. It wasn't like a sharp pain, it wasn't a shooting pain. It's like something just doesn't feel right in my abdomen. Something's shuffling wrong. And I had to cup my stomach to make it feel better.
Jenny ended her run and went home, where she took some ibuprofen.
I came home from work one day, and it was a long day, and I was getting kind of nauseous. It wasn't like, you know, when you spin around and get nauseous from that, it wasn't like that. It was more, something's wrong in my midsection. I don't want to eat, but I do want to eat. That's the best way I can describe it. I didn't know if I was just tired from the day, maybe I didn't sleep as good the night before, but I didn't understand why. I just don't feel right.
Jenny took some anti-acid tablets to settle her stomach, but the problem remained. So she went to visit a doctor.
I sat in the doctor's office and ran some blood tests, checked for the flu as well, but the results of the flu test were negative. He just said it was the stomach bug. He said, you'll be fine, no need for any medicine even. It made me feel a little better that a doctor was telling me it's probably nothing. But then at the same time, I was like, well, how can I just keep getting a stomach bug? In the back of my mind, I knew it had to be more. There had to be something else that was triggering this.
The doctor recommended that Jenny alter her diet and eat less rich foods. Jenny complied. Over the next 2 months, she managed her intermittent heart flutters and abdominal pain with over-the-counter medication. One day, at the start of autumn, Jenny was in her office.
I was at work, and as I went to shut the door, I felt like I was going to pass out. And I started to panic a little bit. Oh my gosh, I'm going to be in here by myself blacking out. And I realized I'm not able to see right now. The white spots come and it gets dark. I laid down, and I was able to stop myself from blacking out.
But another problem developed.
At this point, I know I'm gonna throw up. I'm crawling just so I can make it to the trash can. And I just start throwing up. And it's like my insides are coming out.
Jenny struggled to get help.
I took the phone off the hook and dialed her number on speaker and said, I'm sick, something's wrong, I don't know what's going on with me. And she came rushing in there. She's like, oh my God, are you okay? I was like, no, I'm not okay. And she never heard me say that.
Her colleague called the emergency services, and paramedics rushed to her office.
They said, we're going to have to take you, and we're going to have to take you to the stretcher. I remember thinking, I am not getting taken out of my office in a stretcher. But I really was at a point where, for once, I wasn't in control.
After collapsing at work, public relations executive Jenny Taylor was rushed to hospital.
They did a bunch of tests, and the doctor said to me, when he was taking my heartbeat, he said, we can hear something a little funny.
Doctors carried out a full-body MRI. The results revealed something unusual, not with her heart, but in her abdomen.
The doctor said to me, there's some kind of mass inside of your spleen.
The spleen is an organ that filters blood. though it's not seen to be vital. It aids the body's immune system.
I was kind of baffled. There's a mass in my spleen. Like, what do you mean?
A mass could be a benign growth, a sign of infection, or cancer.
Said, okay. And it kind of sunk in then. I realized for the first time that I could die.
For Jenny, there was one person she had to call.
She called me pretty much as soon as she could, and I could just tell instantly that there was something wrong with her.
And I said, Jen, I think it might be cancer. And I just start bawling.
I met with her through breakups and craziness at work, and I had never heard her cry before. I cannot lose her. Like, I cannot imagine my life without Jenny Taylor.
Over the next few months, Jenny visited numerous hospitals. Then, as the holidays approached, Jen took Jenny to Dr. Stephen Minter.
I was working through the CAT scans that were done, and the shape of mass in her spleen was unusual. This was a perfectly round mass in the spleen.
Based on this unusual characteristic, Dr. Minter ruled out cancer.
It's scary, because no one knows what it is, meaning no one can solve it. I don't know when my next day will be my last day at this point.
Dr. Minter took additional blood samples and ran specialized tests. Meanwhile, Jenny went home, and with Jen, she tried to prepare for the holidays.
I will celebrate Hanukkah. I will have a Hanukkah party or have people over for Hanukkah and teach them what it is. But I realized that I wasn't anticipating celebrating anything ever. It's been 6-7 months, and I'm still not feeling right. It's getting worse.
She canceled the party and asked Jen to leave. Doctors worked carefully.
The surgery would have to be done very delicately. to have ruptured any of the cysts during the procedure, she could have died on the table.
The doctors successfully extracted the organ without rupturing the cyst. Jenny is returned to intensive care.
After surgery, Jeff was there because I didn't get sober, Monica. We got to celebrate the 8 days of Jenny. She did 8 little individual presents. They're all meant to keep me through each day in the hospital.
I don't think I've ever been happier in my life.
The life cycle of echinococcus tapeworms begins in the intestines of a dog. There, the tapeworms release eggs through the dog's feces. Humans become infected with echinococcus cysts when they ingest food, water, or soil that contains contaminated dog's feces. This parasite is common in Africa, southern and eastern Europe, and the Middle East.
Jenny believes she contracted echinococcus 3 years prior.
I've been to Israel and did kind of an adventure trip there. And when I was hiking, we filled up canteens off the side of a mountain. I guess the eggs of the parasite could have possibly been in the unfiltered water.
After a week, she left the hospital. She has her health back, but her body will remain more susceptible to infections.
Lastly, you have to take it easier a little bit more. But life is risky, and you're not going to live life without risks. It's more fun that way.
Echinococcus is very rare in the United States, but has been reported in the American Southwest. In endemic regions, the best way to prevent infection with echinococcus parasites is by avoiding food or water that may have been contaminated with dog excrement.
This Christmas was a horrible Christmas.
It was speechless.
Dawn and Manuel Becerra were living in the picturesque community of Sun City, Arizona.
We really like being in a place where we can be outside every day.
Being here is really quiet. That's nice living.
Dawn was a school teacher and Manuel a contractor.
If you look at us as a couple, he makes sure everything's okay and I make sure everything's fun.
But we always make it work out no matter what.
There was one thing Dawn greatly valued.
I am very independent. Although we do a lot together, I do a lot separately too. We've been through very, very difficult things, but having each other has helped us get on through every period.
In the autumn, Dawn was at work.
I started a new kindergarten class that year. We were teaching them the alphabet, all the wonderful little things you do in kindergarten. Mama said, I felt like there was scum, a gritty scum on my teeth. I was confused. I had no idea what was on my teeth. I immediately drank water, but it never went away.
Over the next month, Dawn continued to work.
One day I brought the children outside for recess. And the sun really hurt my eyes. I didn't really think much of it, but I couldn't stay outside with the sun. I put my head down, shut my eyes, and basically the other teacher had to take over for me.
She left the playground and took ibuprofen. For a few weeks, she continued to take medication, but to no avail. So she visited her doctor.
I told the doctor about symptoms I've been having, the mouth symptoms, the bright light symptoms.
The doctor ran numerous tests.
But the doctor told me I did not have anything that they had tested for. And he started lightly bringing up the thought that this was mental. Being told that I might have something that's psychosomatic or an illness that really wasn't there, that I'm manufacturing myself, that was awful. I was just frustrated. I knew there was something wrong with me.
Dawn's strange symptoms lingered, A month later, her family came over for Thanksgiving dinner.
That Thanksgiving was really special. I prepared turkey and cranberries and all those traditional foods.
Don always loves to entertain, so she worked very, very hard to make the best for the relatives.
But my head hurt and I wasn't used to getting headaches. I could barely keep my eyes open. My headache was starting to overtake everything.
She was rubbing her head a lot.
I said, I have to go to bed. I have a really bad headache. I'm so sorry. Everyone enjoy yourself.
Dawn is not a complainer. So I was very concerned.
When the visitors had left, Manuel went to bed.
It was around 12 o'clock at night. Suddenly the bed started shaking really bad. So I turned the lights on. I saw Dawn foaming from the mouth, and her whole body was shaking really bad, and she was biting her tongue. I was really scared, so I called 911.
Paramedics rushed to their house.
The paramedic told me that Dawn was having a seizure.
A seizure is the result of abnormal electronic activity in the brain and can manifest itself in the form of behavioral changes, hallucinations, and convulsions.
I thought she was gonna die.
On the night of Thanksgiving, school teacher Dawn Becerra had suffered a massive seizure. Paramedics stabilized her and rushed her to the hospital. After a few hours, she came round.
I didn't know where I was, and I didn't know what had happened. I was in this room in the hospital, and here's my mom holding my hands and bent over me, staring in my face. That was the worst Thanksgiving on record.
She told me that she loved me. Excuse me. She said thank you for being there for me. She said, thank you for being there for me. That's what she said.
Doctors kept Dawn in the hospital overnight and ran a battery of tests.
The doctor didn't know why I had had seizures. I didn't have a diagnosis other than seizure disorder. So diagnosis of seizure disorder means you're gonna have another seizure. They gave me anti-seizure medication and released me from the hospital. I couldn't just walk outside alone, because I could fall anywhere.
Dawn's life had changed. I have to be there for her.
I was no longer a free agent.
Dawn remained on anti-seizure medication for a month. Then another holiday approached.
This Christmas was a horrible Christmas. I couldn't do anything, I couldn't celebrate, and we pretty much isolated ourselves. Because a seizure could happen at any time to me.
Christmas is very important in my culture, and we couldn't go to my relative's house, so it was very sad.
Dawn and Manuel stayed at home.
We were watching a movie that had flashing lights.
Dawn kept saying no, 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 and started like shaking her fingers.
My last memory was a movie. And then nothingness.
The seizure that she had was very, very long and violent. I was really scared because she was taking medicine and now she got another one.
Manuel called emergency services and paramedics rushed her to the hospital. Where neurosurgeon Dr. Richard Zimmerman took over her case.
Dawn had a serious medical condition that does need attention. Any seizure can be awful. If they lose consciousness, they can clearly be in harm's way.
Doctors ran an MRI on Dawn's brain.
We saw a mass in the part of the brain known to cause seizures. questioned her to identify the mysterious mass. She had a comprehensive workup for patients who have seizures. That includes lifestyle, travel history.
I told the doctor that I'd been in Mexico, that I lived in Mexico.
Having lived in Mexico was a clue that we knew what to look for. This helped doctors to determine a diagnosis.
The doctor said, you have a worm in your brain.
She had a parasite. She had neurocysticercosis.
I completely lost my mind when he told me that.
Neurocysticercosis is caused by the tapeworm, Tinea solium. A tapeworm larva had migrated through Dawn's body until it reached her brain. There, the parasite turned into a hardened cyst. Over time, the infection caused severe inflammation of the brain, resulting in her light sensitivity, headaches, and seizures.
It was specialist.
Tinea solium have a brilliant defense mechanism. The insistent larvae secrete a chemical that helps them fly under the radar of the immune system. But after several years, the cysts die, and then they stop secreting that chemical. The immune system, in turn, recognizes the foreign bodies and launches a massive attack on the cysts, causing that area of the brain to become inflamed.
The MRI revealed that the cyst was located in Dawn's frontal lobe. The frontal lobe has a lot of functions, including executive function like thinking and calculating things, movement or language. That function could stop.
I was devastated when I heard that.
Waking up and seeing them all. Oh, okay.